With the PowerPoint?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. All right, so. Okay, so if you could, again, thanks, and thanks for taking the time, and we welcome you to this lunch and learn session of BadgerLine User Group. My name is Thiago Palaniappan. I'm a mechanical engineer. I work for a company called TriStar. Many of you might have seen my presentations in the past. I've been presenting in the BadgerLine user group and several other user groups across the country. Before we start, like Deb mentioned, if you could please mute yourself on the audio, you would appreciate it. So if you could start typing in any questions you may have in the chat session, I'm thinking towards the back end of the presentation, maybe the last 5-10 minutes, we could quickly do a Q&A session if possible. So as for the topic, I know last time, the one I did was Creo 7, what's new. So this time we decided to do like a general tips and tricks on Creo. So from an agenda standpoint, before I go to the agenda, just a quick overview for those who are not familiar with TriStar, right? If you're not familiar with TriStar, we are a company that specializes in helping, I would say, manufacturing companies adopt software systems and processes, right? To enable better and more efficient product development. And we do that by being the largest reseller worldwide for PTC, right? We're headquartered in Phoenix. And then we do have application engineers and our sales team in the United States and Canada. I'm based out of the Chicago region. I've been here for the last 15, 20 years. So with that said, let's get into the agenda here. I thought maybe, some of you may be using Creo 7, some of you may be in 6, 5, 4, 3, it doesn't matter. And some of you may be experienced users, some of you may be relatively new. So hopefully the next hour or so, everybody, you're going to get some kind of a little tips or tricks here, I'm assuming. Because over my years with consulting and training classes for customers, I've always seen certain areas that they're not aware of. So I just put together a little bit of general tips and tricks across Sketcher, part modeling, assembly, right? Different areas, selection techniques. Hopefully it helps you in your day-to-day Creo areas. I would say the core areas, that might be useful, I'm hoping. So if you have any questions, feel free to start typing the chat session and I'll try my best to get to it. I'll be switching between the slides and Creo, mainly spending more time in Creo, but let's go over one by one here. So first of all, this is, many of you may be using it for those who are not using it. Back in the old Pro Engineer wildfire days, back in 2006, PTC had introduced a Sketcher palette. I think it's one of the most underutilized items in the Sketch environment where PTC has a default, but during my industry days, I used to customize it, as you can see here, right? I used to have set up a config where I would create our own folders. For example, I used to work at a sheet metal design house where we would have those corner notches that are custom made. Maybe we would just go and create our own profiles that you don't want to redo again and again. Or it could be any sketch that instead of recreating it, rather than reinventing the wheel, it's a good practice to save it there, right? So that's one thing you could take advantage of. And there was a config pro where you could even create your own sections, point it to a location, and it'll be helpful. So let's take a quick look before we move on to the next one. I have Creo 7 right now, and by the way, this works in all releases of Creo, all the way from the wildfire, so nothing Creo 7 specific. If I open up, let's say if I create a new empty part right now, and if I say I wanna do a sketch on one of them, right? The Sketcher palette is one thing that I've seen not a lot of people take advantage of, but it's very useful, I think. If I go to Sketcher palette, I already have this palette, done in here in my directory, but you could see by default, you would get polygons, profiles, shapes, and stars. That's what you get by default. For example, instead of really doing, for example, I've seen many customers, they would just actually manually sketch something here, right? Maybe let me just go, and they would go to their, let's see here, I could do a three tangent arc, maybe. And then they would manually, start sketching it, which is fine, but, rather than spending the time and then doing all that, the trimming and all that, then creating it, why reinvent the wheel, right? So we just go to Sketcher palette and you have your little shapes in here. There's quite a few, right? Polygons, profiles, and anything customized by your company. You would just drag and drop that over here. And then you can just, you know, move over. You can just do a right mouse drag to move your origin. You can rotate it, resize it, have an access point to automatically create the axis, et cetera, right? That's just one of the advantages of Sketcher palette. And now you might have some existing designs, right? So you might have, for example, I'm gonna go to one of my folder here. And let's see here, I'm gonna set that as my work directory, or this could potentially be your workspace if you're in Windchill. And I'm gonna create, I'm gonna open an existing model. Well, let's see here, if I could open up a part. Let's say I would like to reuse some sketches from here, right? I'm editing the definition of this guy. I'm editing into the sketch environment real quick. And I don't want to be redoing this again. I would like to have it in my palette, right? So how do I do it? Right now, if I click on Sketcher palette, there's nothing in there. It's just the four default ones, right? I should just be able to simply save it as, right? I can do a save as. And it saves as a .sec file, which you can, you know, put it in your Windchill library context, or it could be in a network drive location if you don't use Windchill, right? So I'm going to just call it, some name here. And the next time when I go into a new part or anything, right? So when I do a new part, for example, I don't have to worry about redoing that sketch. I'm able to simply go to Sketch Environment, I go to Sketcher Palette, and there you go, right? I have the current work directory that I have active. If that has any sketches, it will display. Or if you have a lot of these sections, you could just go to your config and you could add a config, right? You could just go a 2D palette path, right? What this allows you to do is select a network drive or even a Windchill library context location where you could be storing all your section files so it could be utilized across the enterprise, right? So it's a good practice, and you could even have multiple folders underneath it, and they all kind of will show up here for the common sections that you might be using over and over again, right? So that's one little thing on the Sketcher. Moving on here, one important thing that I've not seen a lot of users know about, some of you may know, but the replace, right? There's different replace functionalities in Creo, right? You can do a replace in assembly, you can do a replace in sketch mode, you can do a replace in part mode, right? Several, three replaces really. We'll talk about assembly later on, but on the part modeling side, one common issue that you run into when you make changes is the missing ID, right? The geometry ID always misses, and you run into issues where you have so many features dependent on it and it fails. So it could be even a drastic change where you're changing, instead of using a line, you're using three entities, or you using a curve instead. Regardless of how you, what is going to be your change, you should still be able to map the geometry ID to be maintained. So currently on the flat surface, the geometry ID is 84, but here the geometry ID is 538. Why did that happen? Because I deleted that and sketched the R. So the system has to give a different ID. And that's why, that's a root cause of many, many failures, right? So how do we prevent something like this is, let's say if I go back to my, just go close some of these here. If I open one of my, got a couple of examples that I'll show you. One is the, so this one here, if I click here redefine, you know, I'm just doing, you know, let's say, I want to just redefine the sketch here real quick. I like the Creo 7 icons for the constraints. It really tells you, if you cursor over it, what it really controls. It's really nice. But this an entity that I would like to delete right now, right? I'm going to delete that entity. As soon as I delete it, I'm sure many of you have come across this warning, right? I call this prepare for failure, right? As you can see, it tells you there's other entities, you know, that are referenced. And I say, okay, let's delete it. And I just do a simple three-point arc from here to here, right? And I'm done with it, but as soon as I'm done with it, what happens is I do get a notification about something failed, right? In a much more complex model, there could be several features dependent on it, but what has really happened if I cursor over this guy, right? If I just, you know, cursor over this right now, it tells me the ID is 527. Now, how did I enable the surface ID? I know I could display the feature ID here, right? That's easy. You can go tree columns and you can display the feature ID. There it is. But what about the surface, every vertex, every edge has an ID, right? If I go to vertex, everything has an ID. So I have enabled a config option. It's pretty nice. You could just go, find and look for show, and then you do a star ID, you could show selected item ID, right? When you set this, its default is no. If you set this to yes, show selected item ID to yes, right? If you search for show an ID, it'll show up. That's the only option there. I've enabled it, and that's why I'm able to see the ID. It's 527 now. Now, let me undo what I did. I did a Control-Z, and I undid that. I'm going to go back before my feature here, and I cursor over it, and now the surface ID is 84, right? And that's why it failed. Pretty easy to understand here, right? So that's kind of why it really failed, you know? So let me do that change quickly again, right? I'm going back to the sketch mode here. I'm going to go just delete that down. Like we did earlier, and I'm going to just go add a three tangent arc right there. Just going through a best practice really here. Right now I'm doing a bad practice, right? Wantedly, I'm just deleting it, and I'm just creating a new one here. And the ID has changed, of course, and there's a reason it failed. So even if I go to my notification, I look at why it failed, right? The side round has failed right there. I should be able to go look up at this reference viewer, right? Very, very useful tool when you get into these type of features where it should highlight it like a broken line right there, telling there's a missing, and there is your missing reference. Now in starting Creo 3, it's nice that they at least show you what used to be the old reference, right? Before it was not happening. So that's a good one, but why did that happen? Because the ID 84 is now something else, right? So I know right now to fix it, I'll have to go back, redefine it and help it, right? I'll have to go back to my sets in here, and then say maybe the driving surface should be this. I've now remapped it to the new ID and now it's fine, right? It's happy with it. But let's say I wanna do the same thing on the other side, but I'll do a bit of better practice here. So I'm gonna go back to the sketch, but in this on the left side, what I'm gonna do is instead of, last time I deleted it, this time I'm gonna do slightly differently, right? I'm gonna draw the arc first, right? And by the way, sometimes when you draw this arc, have you noticed it goes all the way there? Doesn't give you the correct orientation in there. The reason is there is always this little, if you draw the arc, you know, when you start drawing the arc, there's like four quadrants. It depends on how you exit the quadrant. That's all it is. If I go to the left right there and now over here, I'm able to kind of, it doesn't make it tangent automatically, right? I just made it equal to this, that's it. I go to the old one and I replace. It's a very, very powerful feature, being there since the old Pro Engineer days. Back in the 90s, late 90s, and version 16, 17, it has been there. It's nothing new, but it essentially helps keep or maintain that ID. Very, very important when you make changes, right? To make your models robust to design changes. So I'm gonna just select that guy right there. I'm gonna say replace it with this. It's gonna warn about dimensions, that's okay. But the good thing is, if I, in this case, as you can see, the left round didn't fail because the ID, whatever ID it was before, this ID, is the same, you know, the ID 80 before, and it's the same ID. So now, having said that, could we use it for really drastic? That is a simple arc, but could I just go one step further and say maybe even do something like you know, I probably like to have some other geometry here, and that's what this should replace. I have three entities. I got to first divide this guy, right? I got to divide this into three. Right, I could just go divide it randomly somewhere here. I'm gonna divide it there, right? I have like, as you can see, three entities now, right? So having divided an arc into three arcs, now I should be able to just go, and you know, I'm just making up something here just for the sake of an example here. And I could just go to each one of these guys and say, replace this with this, right? I can just go to this old entity, replace, and I could say replace. I think they have another, yeah, I could just go, let's go replace the old with the new. I could always do that. Or I know right now, let me just regenerate that first with, that's kind of why it's not replacing. So it regenerates that ID. There it is. Yeah, I'm going to regenerate it. Now I'm going to go back to this and go back to the sketch here. And I could go to my sketch view right in here. And if I just start saying, okay, let's add, I'm just adding something, some other random shape in here. And to each one of those arcs, replace it with this one, and you see how I was able to replace. Earlier, it didn't replace because I had to make sure the software understands it remaps the ID after the regeneration. I had to exit out of that. Now I can go back to here, and I would say, let's go replace this guy with this. Let's go replace this guy with this, right? If I go to, let me just do it one more time here. We can just go replace that with this entity. There it is. The extrude should work fine and everything, right? But obviously the round will fail in this case. But what I could always go back is, you know, you don't have these two edges in there, and I'm gonna add a little bit of a radius in there, right? So it can map through that. And I can just go, so the changes, right? If you look at going back here, before this round, if you look at the IDs, right? So if you look at my surface ID here, that's still 80. These two are 555. That makes sense. There are new IDs created, which makes sense for the new entities. But the nice thing, it's still maintained part of it. So as long as there's tangency, it will be robust enough to change it. So my point with this, going back to my presentation, is right, when you make changes, it could be one entity to another one entity, or it could be multiple entities. When you do multiple entities, remember, it has to get these separate IDs for these. You've got to regenerate it or update, you know, get out of the feature, but it's quite useful to get, you know, rather than using those missing references, supposed to be a very good practice when you make design changes, right? As always with the Creo. It's been there for a long time, and you should be able to use it in all releases that you're using. It's nothing new in Creo. It's been there for a long time. Another nice replace that I like, that some customers use it, I know, but some of them are not aware, is the ability to replace a solid surface with an existing quilt. Very useful during my industry days when I worked on castings and rounds, and you had these drafts and rounds, and you had sliver surfaces. Or to show you this example here, I may want to quickly replace this and make it flush with this geometry. What would be the best practice around it, right? Just to show you. I mean, there are several ways to do that. You can constrain it when you sketch it, but if I were to go and just show you a few more examples here, there it is. So I have, let me just go to full screen mode, right? I like the full screen mode in Creo 4, where you can just focus on your design rather than focusing on your, your graphics or your interface. Everything is available. So here, I've done some very basic part here, as you can see, right? We just did some, there's an extrude, a couple of additional extrudes here. I removed some weight off of it and add another extrude here. That's pretty much it, right? I would like to make this flush with this surface. I could just do a Control C, Control V, or simply do a copy and paste. When I do that copy paste, I'm essentially extracting the solid surface, and it's creating a quilt in there, right? It's a quilt surface there. I could go to this guy and I can do an offset. Right? I could do an offset. Now, when you do offsets, you got quite a few methods to do offset, right? Are you just doing a surface offset, or are you doing width draft, or are you doing expand, or are you doing replace? Now, this is really, really useful, the replace in here. Used to be tweak, replace back in the old days. Some of you might have used it, but I go to replace and say this one, and there it goes. It becomes flush with that, and that quilt is consumed, right? If I go back to my quilt selection filter, right? You see the quilt is no longer there. So it could be helpful, again, in situations where you have a tiny sliver surface and you're trying to get rid of that, and it might be very useful. So that's another replace. I know it's a part mode replace or the sketch mode replace. Like this, just to go over a few other things in Sketcher and part modeling back and forth here. We'll also see if we can get to some assemblies later on. But in the time we have here, I wanted to go over a few more Sketcher best practices that I call it, like whether you use Creo releases, the newer ones like 4, 5, 6, or 7, or even the old ones, the method with which you would create or apply constraints, right? I mean, you could go and add it from the mini toolbar, but with the new Creo 4.0, but before we had to use a right mouse click, that's all good. But one common question I've seen from many customers is the system trying to assume things for you, right? Many times you want to be under control, and sometimes you like those on-the-fly constraints that PTC assumes, but you could always use a shift key. If you hold down the shift key or use your right-click toggle, kind of like the query selection, enable, disable, lock, it allows you to either lock a constraint or disable the constraint or make it even strong, or delete, you know, all that is available in the right mouse click. Not sure if you've used it, right? I've seen many users, they make it a very long angle first, right, to give a small angle and then change the angle. Rather than that, I don't want to be snapping to horizontal, for example, right? I could just use a shift key. Holding down the shift while sketching will prevent the system from creating constraints automatically. And the tab key allows you to switch from one to the other, right? You can always do that anytime. And holding down the control and selecting the end of any entity allows you to extend it. I don't know if you've used the extend, I'm sure you've used a trim, but holding down the control allows you to extend it. And generally, right, for all users, if in sketch, we recommend doing a rough sketch, constraining it, applying the dimension scheme after that, and then change the value, right? You don't want to go the reverse. You don't want to dimension first. First, you want to apply your design intent using constraint, right? That's generally a good practice. But all this, you know, that I'll see if I can quickly walk you through some of those in here. So if I go to, I just have a sample example here of some basic ones that I show in my demos usually, but there's my constraints, and the best practice always, you do a rough sketch and then you apply your intent, right? If you're, you don't want to worry about dimensions initially, all these weak dimensions. If you cannot resist changing them, simply hide them. Best practice, rough sketch, hide the dimensions here, right? Just hide them, there it is. You could even say, don't create weak dimensions, right? There was even an option to do that. So you only apply your dimensions. But once I'm hiding them, now I know I can just go control select them, right? I'm able to simply control select them, and there are my mini toolbars. So you can make it tangent, coincident, or equal, which makes sense, right? There it is. Those are, when I select two circles, those are the three options I should be getting, right? So there it is, I'm making it equal. I know I could go back to these two guys and say, I want to make them horizontally aligned. I'm just using my, I'm focusing on my design and I'm working on the mini toolbar here, right? And I could say, let's make it coincident. At this point of time where I've constrained the way I want, then I could enable my dimensions and see, okay, so now I'm thinking about manufacturing, I'm thinking about the how should we, what dimension should we give, and okay, should we give center to center from a tolerance stack up standpoint, or should we give the overall distance, right? Those type of, that's now you apply, start applying your intent, right? Or your dimensioning scheme here. Okay, this is what I want rather. You know, this one, yes, I would like to have this guy as a strong dimension. It's really nice how, as I cursor over it, it clearly highlights with Creo 7 as to what it's controlling. What is this guy controlling? What is this guy controlling? Very nice, right? Nice little enhancement there by PTC with the new release, I thought. So just to give you an idea on some best practice on Sketcher. Now, what about, let me just get rid of this. And as I sketch things, right, I'm sketching some entity here. And as I'm sketching, the system always assumes it for me, things for me. If I hold down the shift key, it doesn't assume anything. I'm, you know, that's temporarily removed. Kind of like the old, remember the intent manager without that. So the software doesn't have any intent right now to snap things, right? I'm just sketching my, the way I want kind of. If I let go the shift, there it is. It's back trying to snap in there. And, or another way is you could right click. I'm holding, I'm not holding down the right mouse. So I'm just doing a little toggle on the right click. And you see how it's right now, it's deleted, right? I could just go, I know, and enable it. I want to lock it. So when would you, could you use that, right? That kind of a situation where you might want to switch between multiple constraints. So for example, I may want to access, let's see here, another sketch so I could show you a better example here. I'm going to hide my dimensions and all that for now. But when I go into my line tool, and then when I, as I sketch my lines here, right? I'm doing some sketching, but as I'm dragging this over, right? As I'm dragging this entity, you could see at some point, at one point of time here, I'm getting two constraints here, right? It's trying to make it parallel and equal. Right now, what is active? The equal constraint, right? Now, how do I control that? I could use a tab in my keyboard, a little, you know, tip in here. This is all available in the Wildfire days also, where I could switch between one and the other. So I could say, maybe I don't want equal, right? I could just go right click and say, don't make it equal. However, I want to make it parallel. So I could go back to the other one using my tab and I keep doing a right click until I lock it. So now it's locked in that direction there and it's a strong constraint. And of course I could kind of finish it and all that. You can always delete that constraint here and you know, that's always possible, but it's just that during the sketch, this whole shift, all that would help, right? And also extending any entities, right? You hold down the control key And you're able to extend any entity, right? You can extend any entity. I know here I would have just done the trim corner and I could just go do that. But there are times where you might want to extend an entity, rather than, playing with the constraints and all that, you should just be able to just go control, hold on the control key and you could still extend it. I've extended that, I'm holding on the control as I'm extending it. So a couple of nice things there that I've not seen a lot of customers take advantage of that might help. And of course, I showed you when you bring in sketches, you're able to always, scale, rotate, resize. I did that on that slot from the Sketcher palette. If you do a right drag, you can change the origin. That's very useful. And you can also refit. There's a nice config option that I like, toggling it on and off, depending on what I'm doing. I'm assuming you probably know this, Sketcher refit after dim modify. If you set that to yes, each time you make a modification, it's gonna refit or, it's gonna go to a full view. There are times that I'm focused on a complex sketch or certain areas, and I'd like to be working on that as I change the dimension. You could set it to no. In Creo 7, they've set it to no, but it's nice to kind of either use one or the other, right? And some of the configs like this, where it's you would like to toggle it back and forth, I personally recommend adding it to a favorite, right? I don't know if you've done that. We all know config.pro controls your Creo. It's kind of like your Creo settings, your environment, the way it works. However, certain settings like this, I'd like to go back and toggle it on and off. Wouldn't it be nice to have it under favorites right here that I can turn it on and off? So sometimes I use multiple skeletons, sometimes I don't. Sometimes I use a specific whole parameter file search path. Sometimes I use a different one. And I know all these could be mapped with the map keys too, but it's nice to have these favorite config options. The way you do that is you just go to your config and right click and add to favorite and it'll show up here. And many times you might be wondering, what do these different icons mean for configs, right? Sometimes it's a screen, sometimes it's a little wand and sometimes it's this lightning bolt. So it really means that config, if you change with lightning on it, it means it'll take effect immediately. If it's a screen, it's going to take effect the next time when you launch Creo. Sometimes you're going to notice, okay, change this config, but nothing happened. You'll have to restart Creo. How do you know that? It's right next to the config there. Or if it's a magic wand, it'll only take effect for this pro unit mass is going to take effect only for the next part I create, not for existing parts. It's not retroactive. You see what I'm getting at, right? So those are maybe, before I move on to the next one here, let's see. So the other things that I thought could help here, if I go to, if I open up, I'm gonna create a new part. And if I just go use my sketch or something here and go to my sketch view. And if I go to my file system and I'm gonna use one of these sections here, we'll just use a section like this, right? I brought in and obviously I might want to constrain this guy to the corner here. The way I do that is right mouse drag, right? I'm holding down the right mouse button, left mouse button here. And I'll just place it for some scaling factor here, maybe 0.25, 25% of the original one. There it goes, right? And I'm gonna enable my dimensions as well, right? There it is. Now in my config, if I go to my config, I don't have any favorites right now. I've just had it clean here, but if I go to my existing config, I may want to go just do a sketch refit config, right? So if I search for refit, I have Sketcher refit after demodifying. I could just set that to, for example, yes, right? I want you to refit after each modify, right? If I set it, or right now, let me leave it at no. It's something I might turn back and on and off, depending on the sketch I'm doing. I could just right click and add it to a favorite. So when I do that, and I go to my favorites, it's there to turn on and off anytime I want. So Sketcher, you're just saying a yes or no right there, right? There are times that I want to have it, I hit okay, I'm not going to change my config, it's just in the session here. I've zoomed into this area and I'm going to just set this to 15 or something. You see how it refits? There are times that sometimes I might be working on this area and I don't want that to happen. I'm working on some certain areas and I don't want that to happen. So I could just go back to my options and in my favorites, I could say, just toggle it off right there. And I'm just gonna, let's set it back to whatever it was. See, this time the change happened while I was still in that view. It didn't refit every time and you had to zoom in, zoom out. So, I mean, it's something that different users prefer it differently right there, but you could always turn it on and off. So let's say by default, I prefer it on for the most part, but you could always turn it off too. So like that, you could have several other configs that you might want. So for example, I could go to my options config. There could be some paths in here. Model tree config, I may be using different model tree options there. There could be certain things like that even has like, this is for a plugin that I have for a specific other software. I could just go add that to the favorite. And then if I go to my favorites, there it is, right? There is like an alias plugin I have, right? Creo alias plugin, I might use specific plugin folder, there it is. So like that, pretty much any config that you have here. So there it is, my simulation solver memory allocation. That's something that I might play with every time. I just add to my favorite, I go to my favorite in there, that's there for you, right? So yeah, mainly it's helpful for these toggling on and off, right? You have a kind of a list of things that you keep changing often, right? That's really what I'm getting at here. Let me get to a few other things. Lock scale is useful, right? Whenever you sketch, change your value, of, when you change the dimension value, sometimes you'll see it work, sometimes it doesn't work. This nice little lock scale is huge. Some of you may know this, some of you may not know this, but if I go back to my Creo here real quick, and I can quickly open up a specific design here. And if I could go and edit definition, one of these. So there it is, right? I have something like nicely defined and everything. It's not closed, obviously, but if I go and change this, it highlights this controlling this to this, right? From the vertex. I'm gonna set it to 16. Looks like it works, right? That didn't have a problem to flip, right? So there it goes. But if I go change this guy and make it to a low, small value, it has a problem. Many times you will see this, right? Regeneration failed and try alternate and all that. I mean, if you look at the message, it'll tell you why, right? And it'll tell you that it couldn't figure out the end of this arc was constrained to that, and that's why it couldn't do it, or this itself is 140. And so in such situations, the best practice is just, you know, select all of them and use the modify, right? You just go change them together. When you change them together, you get to go to the lock scale, very, very useful, right? The lock scale option. So, you know, this 292, I could just set it to 16 or something like that right there. And it will maintain the proportion and change all of them. You're almost like scaling it down. I put it 16 and I click okay. And you see how it kind of refits to what I want, right? They're all like 8, 20 and everything there. So might be helpful for the initial sketch you do, right? The lock scale. Similarly, there are several other configs that you could take advantage of, like, I don't want accidental modification of my sketch. Lock modified dimensions automatically. When you change them, you're creating a change so that others cannot change them accidentally by dragging them, right? They should still be able to change them by editing it here, but not by changing the geometry. And sketcher dimension auto lock, automatically lock all dimensions I create. You'd also use that, right? So a couple of nice options there. Now, a few other things, general tips in Sketcher is, before we move on here, is the sketch region. And sometimes there are benefits of open sketching. I understand as a best practice, we always recommend using closed sketches, right? We always recommend closed sketches, but there are times that an open sketch might come in handy. And also the sketch region that they introduced in Creo 5, that's very handy where you could have boundaries, you could have actual multiple sketches or single sketches, but you're able to select sketch regions moving forward when you do a fill surface or a revolve or an extrude, especially when you use skeleton-based modeling, these could be helpful. Let me just spend a couple, a minute here just to go over that, those new concepts that some of you might be new, some of you might have used it too, I'm thinking. There it is, okay. Let me go into a part here. So right now, if I go and I have a sketch and if I extrude this, that's simple, straightforward here. And many times you'll have to do additional geometry, maybe get this and do a sketch and all that, or use it replace and all that. But instead of using a closed sketch, I have four lines. Here I have three lines. That's the only difference. If I extrude this, it'll be a surface by default, but if I make it a solid, you see how the system, I didn't do anything, it understands to confirm or follow that. When is it gonna fail? Obviously, when there is no area at the top, that's when it's gonna fail, right? For a solid, it has to be capped at the other end too, right? So there it is. So that might be handy So even though closed sketch is recommended, sometimes there could be benefits of open sketches or something like this here. If I do an extrude here, you see, there it is. It doesn't conform to this geometry. But if I have just the U without the little arc in there, if I go extrude, again, if I go and do a solid, there it is, right? So there it goes. It has that, it's almost working like a rib in there, right? Like a rib feature where the rib's purpose is to make it as confirmed as possible, right? And one other thing while we are on this one is you could also take advantage of surface regions. So the surface regions are very helpful. So if I go into, let's see here, if I could open up some part here and, you know, I'm just gonna go sketch real quick. I'll just do some random shapes here real quick, just so you get the idea. So I got some sketches done here. I probably have a sketch here, probably have, let's also get rid of the dimensions for now, so as I'm just focusing on the sketch region here. So I got some sketches and I got boundaries and, you know, I didn't have to really go trim or anything. I have that boundary itself of the actual geometry, the edge. And that's pretty much it, right? This could be multiple sketches or a single sketch, could be part of a skeleton, what have you. The key is it has to be visible. If it's hidden, it cannot be used for sketch region. How do I switch from geometry to sketch region? There's a little built-in map key or a keyboard shortcut. You could just go Shift S. Use a Shift S, as you can see, it just goes to sketch region. If I go to Shift G, it will switch to geometry. Now, is there a list of all these? Where do we go look for all the existing keyboard shortcuts? I go to File Options, Keyboard Shortcuts, and there, since Creo 4, they have a lot of built-in map keys. You could, I know many of you may have your own map keys, but you could go Command with Assigned Shortcuts. These are all the commands that are already existing there, right? You could go and Shift G, see Geometry Filter Selection. There it is. You could even change them. If it comes up with a conflict, it might see there's another conflict. It'll let you know there's a map key with it. You could even say commands without assigned shortcuts, and you can create your own for all the commands. It's much better, right? For area, I want, I don't know, Control A or A or something, and type in here, right? So that's very useful. So if I go to Shift G or S to go to sketch region, I should be able to just select these regions. That's really nice that you don't have to, unlike before, you don't have to go use edge, copy edge and all that. It's happening behind the scenes for you. When I do that extrude right now, whether it's removing material or for adding material, what's happening behind the scenes, if I go to my sketch, it has, if you see here, it has done all my use edge or copy edge or project edge. Remember this one here, many of you would be, I'm sure, are using the project edge. That's what is happening behind the scenes. It's taking a subset of the geometry and the existing sketch, and it's copying into it or projecting onto it, and it's an internal sketch right now, right? It's a nice way to use existing ones. We're not spending a lot of time, editing or, you know, going back and, so can you see this one here? That would be a region, this would be a region, this would be a region. I can even use this for revolve purposes. So I could just use it for revolving, for creating fill surface, there's my axis, and I'm able to do all that, right? So it's one of the Creo 5, this is a Creo 5 enhancement, the sketch region itself. So if you have multiple sketches or even multiple multi-featured ones, you no longer have to go like in the past where you go to sketch, you go into sketch mode and you would go project this, right, project this, and you would do all your little trimming, right? You know, okay, that should be gone, and you close out here, or maybe you project this edge, and then say, okay, well, I want to trim it. You know, that's not required anymore. I was able to, that's automated behind the scenes, is what I'm getting at here, right? It's automated. I didn't have to do anything. The only thing is I'll have to use sketch region here, right? So that's the nice thing that they introduced. I thought it's a nice little one. I've not seen it. A lot of users take advantage of it is there since Creo 5, right? And then you can go to the import data. I'm sure this is something a lot of customers go through where they might want to import from another drawing, from a DWG or a DXF. And many times you get this error, right? You're trying to import too many entities and it just doesn't come up sometimes. It could be a very complex spline or a lot of data in there. One little tip here, which some of you might know, but those who don't know, you could just uncheck dimension display and dimension constraints before doing the import so that the system is not trying to calculate the dimensioning schemes and the the weak dimensions and all that, at the same time trying to pull it in. You see what I'm getting at? And that'll help. To kind of demonstrate that, if I go into, let's see here, if I could open up an existing one, might have a part here that I've, you know, it's the same one that we did that little replace, but I might want to add a logo or something here. I know I'm going to go into my offset feature here, and I'm going to do offset with draft. So, you know, and then when I do that, I have to add a sketch, right? Somewhat like an emboss feature maybe, or text feature that I might want to add in there. And I'm going to just use some references here. So maybe we'll add some additional references up here. Okay, now in sketch view, right? In my sketch environment, I can just go, by the way, I really like this clipping tool in Sketch they introduced in Creo 4. Very nice, right? I mean, it clips it for you. You see the sketching plane, everything in front of the sketching plane, it gets removed automatically for you, right? Very useful there. And not only that, now coming to the main thing, when I go file system and when I import data, right, into the sketch, for example, I might want to import from a drawing here. So let's say I want to go, I might have some DWG or DRW, a DRW file here, just a drawing file, but I don't want everything, but I get to select only this, right? I might want to import that, I middle click into it. And before I bring it in, right, usually what happens is there are times that it's, if I go to my, before I bring it in, it's a good practice not to enable constraints or dimensions. Sometimes it crashes, sometimes it, depending on how complex that is, it's not able to really bring it in. So I would uncheck both my dimensions and constraints. You're stressing the system less and you're turning it and they're saying, okay, give this geometry to me first. Let's get it where it wants to be, or, you know, scale it down, what have you. And then maybe once you're done with it, yes, obviously you can go and enable your dimensions and enable your constraints, et cetera. It's supposed to be like a good practice whenever you do this. And since I did the offset command, I can even attach a, I can offset it and I can give it a specific, draft angle and all that in one shot, right? So maybe that would be a specific color that I might want, something like, that's the color I might want in there. So just another one that I've seen. Some of these are some not common questions I've gotten from customers over the years. I thought I'd put together as a tip here. And orientation, right, in Sketcher too. When I orient from one plane to another plane, the old school method is still there, but there's a much better way now where you can just go right click section orientation and change that. It's much, much faster and easier to do. It really helps, I think. So for example, if I want to go and let's see here, if I could open up some design here, I'm going to sketch on this profile here. Let's go to sketch view in here. And I might want to sketch on this face, but normally we go into sketch setup here and say, okay, this right should be facing the bottom of my screen, right? Or should be facing the left of my screen, rather than doing all that, right? So let's leave it at right is right, right? I'm not going to change that. I can go section orientation. It's been there since Creo 2, Creo 3.0 and 2.0. So I'm able to just go up here and say, I want this to be my horizontal reference. That's really what I'm asking for. I can also flip that right in here, flip the section orientation so it'll flip it to the bottom or top. You still have those options, but it's all right in here. You can go flip the section orientation again. How am I viewing it? Is it from here or from the other side? I can just go flip that the sketching plane. See how in which direction I'm going to view. Everything is up here. And the advantage of this is when I'm drawing some my design intent is, it's just easier, right? I mean, the design intent always remains parallel to that, or, you know, that's the goal here, right? And so if any change happens to this guy, you see that will stay parallel. And I'm, you know, there's a different way to do it too, using an angle and then going, you know, sketching it like this, but it's just a user convenience that helps, I think. In Sketcher, the known dimension is very useful. You could use it to do relations at the sketch level. So it helps from a regeneration standpoint, right? I can just go, there's nothing sketched here. I'm just selecting these two entities and I'm adding a known dimension and I could use it in a Sketcher relation. Very, very useful. And just a few, one last thing here before we kind of open up for a little Q&A and here, just another 5 minutes, we'll probably do a Q&A. It's the fillet itself, right? I mean, we don't want to do fillet in the Sketcher unless it's absolutely necessary, right? Unless you have like a situation where for manufacturing, you want to give the theoretical sharp and then give the bend radius to control. For a sketch like this, you know, best practice is not to include that fillet in there. Do it as a sharp edge, but then you could use intent chain or intent surface to create your rounds. It's something that many of you might know, some of you may not know. It's almost like selecting a concept, going back to my geometry ID thing where every edge has a geometry ID, right? Is there a way to select that as a concept so even if a change happens in the future, I shouldn't be keeping track of my round or draft? How is that possible? Rather than having so many edge references, each having its own ID, could we just pick the intent, right? And the intent could be, again, different intents, right? This itself could be an intent, the sketch profile. And then the extruded edges could be an intent. You can even define your own intent. It's very, very useful when you make changes. So what I'm talking about here is there's a couple of nice config options too when you're working on intent chain. So if I go to my part here, just some part in here, and I'm just doing a quick change to this, right? I might later on I might change this here, right? I might change it to somewhere here and everything. I still want that round to work as it would, right? So there's when I do my round, normally you would go to your round and you would say, okay, so for example, you would just select one, you go control key maybe, right? That's what most users do and they do a round. But when you go to the sets, there's so many sets. So if you look at the IDs now I have for that round, if I go to the round and if I go reference viewer and if I look at these IDs, there's it, right? This is a bad practice. Edge ID 72 all the way through 74, you have picked ID. So any change, if that hexagon becomes a rectangle, you know what's gonna happen. The IDs will change and the round fails, or some of them will have, some of them will not have, et cetera, right? So that, so in such a situation, a better practice, rather than using all this, I'm gonna clear all of those. I just use right click and then it picks up the intent edge. So what is it doing? It's the feature ID, right? It's picking up the concept in there. And if you look at your sets, it's nothing new. It's been there for a long time. And there was an intent edge and it has picked up all those edges in there and I can give it a specific radius. Now I can just go to this post or, and I should be able to just go maybe change the sketch in here and to whatever it is, right? Something else. We can just go to the sketcher palette and include something else or maybe add whatever, right? Whatever shape with multiple edges. The only time it's going to fail is when it's a round where it doesn't have edges. That round should accommodate, right? Same thing. I could also add an intent edge along this. So when it goes along any of these, right? For example, when I do a round and I'm going to do a round here, I query select it, I get intent chain. Or I could just go right click, pick from the list, and I could grab the intent edge. That's also useful, right? I grab the intent edge and there it is, right? I can add that intent edge there. And now if I go edit it or move it around, depending on what kind of changes you've done right there, right? You could just go change this move over here and you see it still follows that in there, right? It's how is it gonna follow? It does whatever it can, right? It's going up here. So it's you can see the how robust it is, right? That intent chain is something you could use it in drafts, you could use it in edges, right? A lot of places where you could use that. So that's just some of the other on the part modeling side, right? Again, to avoid failures, try to replace. You could use replace like I showed earlier or use edit references. I really like edit references also, the old reroute, which kind of tells you what is missing. It highlights it. You can go grab it or grab the intent chain so it won't fail moving forward, right? Starting Creo 3, PTC does show, Creo does show if things are missing, I'm sure you know that. And this control alt shift, right? This is huge, right? I mean, there are different areas in Creo where you use control. Sometimes you use a shift key. Sometimes you use control plus alt. There's different areas here. Just to give you some little tips in here that cross the board, whether you're in sheet metal or part modeling or assembly, it's quite useful. So if I go to, some of my, maybe I'm going to open up a simple, could be like a sheet metal part or something like this, but I know normally you would go, select one and you do your flange wall, for example, But have you tried using, you know, when you do the flange wall and you select, instead of selecting one, if you select hold shift and grab the surface loop, it does that in one shot, right? I understand sometimes you might have some of them in different lengths we can extend, but this is much better than just doing it one by one, right? It's, I had to hold the shift to grab all of them. Now, not only that, you could also use the shift key in places like, for example, if I were to go back to my another example here, if I want to select multiple geometries quickly, right? I got a very, I mean, it's a, as you can see, it's like a shelled design here. And I might want to grab all the surfaces inside to apply a pressure load or do an offset or copy or what have you. I shouldn't be spending my time doing control. And I understand you could do like a grab select, but it's still going to be time consuming. So I could do the select one surface, and then I could do the shift, pull down shift, and I'm grabbing the side surface. I'm gonna go do the shift and grab this side surface. And what am I doing is I'm limiting it with those boundaries, right? There are three boundaries in there. So when I'm holding shift, I'm essentially collecting the boundaries wherein it's bounded now, and now it doesn't flow to the other side. All the seed surfaces are selected. It's really like saying, if you had a sheet metal, you know, imagine like a form feature, like a die or a punch in there, I'm just selecting a seed surface and these are my boundaries. And it grabs everything between the seed and the boundary. All I had to do is select the seed first, shift, and grab the boundary. Now I could copy this. So if I go into one selected, you see, it's not multiple entities. If I double click on this node, I'm sure many of you know this, double click on the node gives you more information of what you just selected. It's a seed and boundary surface there. Okay, so, yeah, I know we are, I had a few more slides in there on a few other things, but I think we're running out of time on UDFs and patterns and a few things. Maybe we could continue on this on the next user group event meeting here, but let me see if we have any questions in the chat session. Let me just go and see. So I don't know, Deb, are you able to read the chat session? Let me just see if I can read it. Probably stop sharing my screen somewhere here.
There weren't too many things in the chat.
Okay.
But you probably can see, I don't know if those people are still on if they want to speak.
Yeah, if it's not a lot of them, you can even unmute them and hopefully all this, I know it was a quick rundown on a few things that I normally show in the tips and tricks session, but any questions based on what I showed or anything else unrelated, that's fine too.
I'd like to know what energy drink you have in the morning.
That's good.
Thank you. I mean, usually the more I just wanted to kind of sprinkle you all with as much information as possible in small amount of time, right? So that, you know, there's could be several of these. Some of you may have used, some of you may not have used. That's why I hope you didn't mind the pace and the energy, but yeah, thanks for the question.
So I was asking about in replace, is there a way to keep it from swapping end directions or swapping front and back of a surface to choose orientation? Because it seems to kind of do what it wants on those.
I see. What you're talking about is like, are you talking about datum plane orientation or a surface, actual surface, right?
Actual surface, or so when you're doing a replace of a straight line to an arc or whatever.
Sometimes
the left end becomes the right end type of thing.
Oh, I see what you mean. Okay, let me actually go to that example that I was showing you here real quick. So maybe we could just try that out here. So if I go to my sketch, if I go to sketch view, right? So what you're saying is if I had there it is, right? It depends on where, how you sketch it from, which side, there it goes. What you're saying is does the vertex ID gets flipped, right? Is that kind of your question, I think?
Exactly.
Okay, got it. So yeah, that's one thing I wish we had a control on that. If you see right now, if I go back to, just hit okay out of this and you go back in time, right? I'm gonna go back to insert mode. And if I go to my surface ID right now is 84, but this Edge ID, right now it's showing 161 since I've enabled the config. And this guy, I've enabled it, it shows 120, right? 120 and 161. So let's see if that, yeah, I don't think there's a way to, you know, to control that. I think it is automatically determined if it's, because when I replace this, I would assume it's also going to replace that, but let's see if it can, unless you want to, you know, do point by point, vertex by vertex replace, that might be a little more tedious, but we should be able to try it out and see if I go, let's see here, if I go to one of these in here, I added the, it also might depend how I sketch the arc, I think, right? Remember, I started from here to here. So the bottom was 161 or something before. So let's see if I go to this and say, I want to replace with this guy. I replaced it. I hit OK and everything. And I know the surface ID should be the same, right? If the cursor over, that's good, right? ID remains the same, and that's why it's going to be robust. But I'm curious to see this one. 61 actually, and 161 and 120 remain the same. That kind of answers your question. I think when you flip, when you change or when you replace, try sketching that new entity start point from here to here, so it picks up that vertex first and then this vertex. Hopefully that answers your question. I think didn't need to flip, but I do remember I sketched it from here to there. Right? I'm wondering if I'd sketch from the top to bottom, then the flip the ID of the edge, but yeah, that's a very good point, because you might have another round in here, right? In this case,
like, yep, exactly.
Yeah, in this case, luckily I had, you know, the side round in here. So whoever did this guy, right? It's whoever did this, where's the other, the top or the bottom round? It depends on what they clicked, right? Did they click on, let's say if I clear this, if they had clicked on this, there's a chance to failure versus this. It so happened I would have, as a best practice here, rather than even doing edge, I would have done surface, controlled surface, right? I mean, surface is the best. The reason is, like to your point, where this edge IDs and vertex IDs doesn't come into play, it is really the surface and the surface ID, and that's more stable, right? As always, we say, datum planes are better parents, and then surface are better parents than edges. That it goes back to that, but very good question. Yeah, that's, but yeah.
As a kind of corollary similar one is, the same thing happens when you do a replace of a surface. So I'd say a feature fails and you do a replace reference.
Yes.
And sometimes if you're offsetting out, when you replace it, it switches everything that's offsetting to the opposite direction, inboard or something like that. Is there a way to control which direction that replace happens?
I see what you mean. Are you talking about the offset replace?
No, not an offset replace. So say you have an offset surface as one of your features, just a normal offset surface as one of your features.
Got it.
And something fails and you do a reference replace. Sometimes that direction, what is out becomes in. And vice versa.
I see what you mean. That is there a way, kind of like, I see exactly. Yeah, yeah. There's no config I know for that. It's more like you really want, when we do like a plane offset, we do can control the, you know, the positive side and the negative side.
Yep,
right?
Exactly.
Yeah, that's actually a very good enhancement trick, as I'm thinking about it, right? When you do changes where you're saying, for when I design something, I might be using this, but moving forward, allow me to use this. At that time, it'll be nice to control that flip rather than have it built in us how it uses those edge IDs, right? These ones, that's, I see what you mean. Yeah, yeah, that's gonna be a good, yeah, I know there's one config, but that doesn't, there's one config I know I used to use during my industry days, used to be called, I think it starts with provide, if I remember correctly. It provide pick messages always. And I know, let me see if that gives you a little bit of, we should try it real quick. So what that does is provide pick message always set to yes. If you do that, right, I'm just gonna leave it on. So let's say I had, probably let's do it on a fresh new part here. If I do a little, let's see, something like this, and we'll just go add something here. But if I go add another one in here and go, we'll just use that sketcher palette or something here. We'll just go to the racetrack, something like that. And maybe There it is, okay. Now, when I go to the intent edge of this, you know, so I know there's an ID here, right? 89 and all that. So I might also have, if I go to the, where is it? Pick from list. Do you see you got like two different, I'm thinking this might help with a little bit with your question here. So there are two intent chains, right? I know this is, looks like a different thing that I'm showing, but it might probably help you. So every service has an intent too. So why is there two? What is the difference between the two? Since I had enabled that config, you see how at the bottom, one intent chain is feature number 6 and the part, whereas the other intent chain is feature number 6 and the surfaces. So what this tells you is I could have another feature here extruded, and this is to the part, this is to the surface to surface. If I, depending on which ID I pick, even though we don't have a direction thing when you do an offset, if you do get the chance of selecting two different, what is it called, the intent chain, should this fail the round that I'm gonna actually, let me demonstrate that a little bit here, that might be easier to, just if I do one more feature here, or I'll just do some shape here. And if I go and maybe go shift snap to that, right? So it snapped to that one. And if I go and add to that first ID, right? I mean, if I go to that first one, which it shows to the part, which it should be the stable one, right? Anywhere in the part. And if I do a round, it shouldn't matter what direction you're offsetting it. I'm sure the same thing should work with your edit references too. When you're doing the replace reference, maybe if you do a one more query select, are you getting two options, is my point here, because no matter where it intersects, it should, you see how it understands to flow through that because it's to the part. But sometimes I've seen it right now, it doesn't fail there too, even wherever I put in there, right? It doesn't change. But if I go to, let's see here, if I could go, if I had done the other way around, let me just delete that feature here. And if I had done that second intent chain, if I better to do it from the list so we can see first intent and the second intent. The second intent is all about surfaces to surfaces. The other one is to the part. It depends on, sometimes this is more stable always, but this one tends to fail because all it's looking for is this surface ID and these IDs, right? If I go to this guy here and say, let's do a round on this one, whatever round that, yeah, we'll just give it some value here. Now if I do that little move, as you can see, did you see, it didn't know to flow to the other side because it's trying to go only between these two surfaces there. I'm thinking, I know this is not an exact question you asked, but I'm thinking when you do your edit references too, moving forward, maybe try, there's no flip, that's for sure, to flip the direction, but maybe when you query select that reference, are you getting two of them? And if you had that provide config that I had shown you, right, in that session, or is it, I think it's, if I go to my current session here, I think this, provide picked message always for previous entities, it should tell you, not the direction, it'll at least tell you, is it to the part or is it to the surface of surface, right? You see that F, feature number 6 in part, and I'm thinking that might help. I'm not 100% sure, we'll have to try it out when you do edit reference, but this might be a workaround, I'm thinking. But sure. Yeah, good questions, yeah. It's,
yep, thank you.
Yeah, no problem. Yeah.
Hey, finally up on this is Jay, I have a question.
Okay, go ahead.
Yeah. So on the model, in the top of the model, you have that zoom, refit, shading, all kinds of icons, right? You know, there's a bar in the middle. Yeah. The from the right side, there are two parallel lines. Can you put your mouse on that to see what are those two parallel lines?
Which you're talking about this one?
In the middle there, right above the model, where you have the datum planes. Resize, refit, zoom. Yeah, right in that panel. On the right side, you have the two parallel lines.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I can show you. That is, so this pause is, you might have heard. Have you seen
in the sketch? You can see that now. It seems like this pause has come to this panel.
Yeah. So this pause is completely to do with nothing going to the modeling side. It's more for our live simulation, right? PTC has this simulation
work
scenes. It's mainly so you can run an analysis, right? And you can pause it. That's why I think it should be if I just do some I think I might have the license in here. Let me see. It should I go to the part and to materials and we'll just assign some metals here, right? We'll just go steel cast or something here. I think I have the material assigned, and if I just go, I want to just go fully fix it here. And if I go, so let's say I want to assign some force or something here.
Okay.
Go to the X direction, we'll just apply about so much from there in that direction, right? We'll just go magnitude direction is what I have, I think. That should be, I didn't select the surface actually. Let's go and go to the loads in here, edit definition on this. And I think that's the direction I wanted. There it goes. And that's it, right? And if I hit display, the system is supposed to, I think I have my license going on here. I didn't have to do meshing or anything, and it's supposed to give you in real time, you know, like you see the deformation and everything, right? So now let's say I want to improve this design, right? I see the high stress and this is where it is. I could just go back to my model mode. And this pause simulation is meant for this actually. You know, normally it's helpful and when you do fluid flow, it doesn't come time. But sometimes what I do, I might go and say, you know what, let's add fill here and see what happens. You see how it paused automatically
at
a radius, and now it kicks in. It's more like that's kind of why they have the pause. It's essentially pausing my simulation.
Simulation. Okay, got it.
Then it's back on it, right? That's good question. That's nothing to do on the modeling side. It's mainly to pause or resume a simulation when you do design changes, right? You might say, okay, well, I might want to make that bigger. I didn't have to go back to the FEA guy and say, you know, any changes. It's in real time. I'm able to get feedback and I call this simulation driven design, right? That's what it feels like. You have somebody telling you if you're going the right direction or not as you make
Got it. Thank you. Yep. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, so I've got 112. Should we end or you want to look at that last question in the chat?
Dan, let's see.
Dan, are you available if to speak?
Yep, I'm right here.
Yeah, go ahead, Dan.
Okay, so in Sketcher, when you are offsetting a chain, I've noticed if that original edge that you're offsetting changes and it causes the feature that you're creating to fail, you are unable to replace individual entities.
Mm.
So you're kind of forced to delete that whole sketch and then re-offset the new chain. Is that correct? Because that's been my experience.
Okay, that's a good question. Let's see if we could quickly do that. Right, I'm just going to do a slot or something here. We'll just go. We'll just do some remote material here. But what you're saying is, if I go back to a new sketch and do that little offset edge,
and then do it by chain.
Now, even here, right? I know the intent chain. I don't think if it's intent chain would be always a good practice. The problem is intent chain don't come there.
Correct.
You could do one thing that I can show you. Yeah. Actually, let's first. There's a manual way to do intent chains. I don't know if you've tried that under datum. There is this reference feature where I could manually create my own intent chains. I'm thinking that might help with this, since you're saying somebody's going to change it and I don't want it to fail. That's what might be the best practice I'm thinking, where I go to intent chain and say, this guy, shift, you're essentially selecting that chain, right? As an intent chain, you're predefining it as an intent. So for downstream features, that is why we have, when you don't get this right click intent, we can do this. I've used it in FEA where I might have some contact surfaces and very, very useful that intent surface and chain. I'm thinking, but before I do this, before even, let's just see the problem that you're mentioning, right? I go to sketch and maybe I go to this sketch here and I might do an offset with a chain and we'll just go from here to here. It just says next, do an accept, we'll convert it to a loop, yes. And then let's say we'll give it an offset of I don't know, 10 or some value there. And let's turn on our constraints and yeah, it should show those little, the new icons they have. And maybe let's say I did something with it, right? I might do a little tick into it. I might just go do some groove or something, what have you. But the goal is if they change this, that should update. And this is the use case I see. But now what you're saying is we might go back to this guy, and we might just say, this is where the replace, let's say I'm gonna delete it, right? I'm gonna delete it and I'm gonna just draw something else here. Maybe you can draw a hexagon or something. Immediately the sketch fails. If I go to, this is what I think situation here. This is what you're talking about, Dan, right? The IDs.
Yeah,
right?
You're unable to replace those.
You want to
individually.
With this and now, so if I go and if I say I want to replace this and I know I want to replace with this, it's technically, this is more like a failed reference. So rather than doing it at this level, if I go, let me undo what I did here. And when I go back to that original sketch, right, this guy here, and when I remember I deleted, redid that. So that's where the key here would be, where these four needs to be, it's almost like saying if I had an external sketch, that shouldn't matter.
Or add a radius in those corners prior to your offset.
Right. Right in here, that would be a good workaround for it to continue. But what I was getting at is if I go edit definition on that, and let's say I am drawing this line here. The only thing is you're gonna replace this to this, this to this, right? This to this. There's nothing for this guy to replace. So
sure.
That's when we may have to use that little other technique I showed you. Sometimes I know it's one of the hit or miss thing where sometimes it does work where that little divide tool right there, I know it's like a blend. I cannot replace a line ID with a point ID, but I should be able to go replace this with this. It sometimes it does help where you do that divide just for the sake of dividing in there. So it's technically, nobody sees that divide, it doesn't create an edge or anything. It's more like when you go back to that sketch, redefine it, you at least ensure that it's regenerated, the system understands it's two entities, we hit okay. Now we could technically go to this one here and say, I wanna replace, let's go back and say replace. I think we might be running into the same thing that you had, I think. It says incorrect choice, must pick new entity. So it doesn't seem to be replacing. Could be that I'm doing it as a fresh new one. Let me just go back to edit definition. I'll just remove that first. Where you're replacing one by one, this could be the same problem that you're running into, I think, when you do it with the...
Or just create another sketch after sketch one that's a smaller box. And in the offset feature, you can't replace the entities with the new one. Because you selected it as a chain.
Got it. I've selected, instead of selecting it as a chain, let me just try one thing, quick thing here. For the same method, instead of doing that as a chain, if I were to go use this reference and intent chain and say, I'm still gonna do this intent chain, but I wanna do a shift, select that as a surface from to loop. So we know we have defined that as a reference, but then now when I do my new extrude, See, the intent edge came up, right? You see that right click, and I'm grabbing that intent. Can you still hear me? It says my internet.
Yep. You just cut out for a second, but you're back.
Oh, really? Okay, got it. So what I did then was the intent changed what I did. It'll be curious to see, I defined a manual intent and I didn't have to use the chain here. I was able to, I don't know if it cut off then, let me undo that and redo it. So I went into offset and I query selected to that intent. So if I go pick from list, I do have those different intents now, and the reference intent is what we want.
Mm-hmm.
That we just did. I guess we could have used the extrude intent itself, but I made sure it's a defined intent. I'm wondering if it shows kind of, there it is. It shows this is to the part, the message window, and this is to the side surfaces. To the part would be more stable, I would think. But the reference is what user defined. You know, we could try. I'm pretty sure the user defined is something I've used in the past. We'll see that should be, or we could do that part also. We'll just go, maybe thicken it, we'll flip it or do something like that. Remove some material here. That shouldn't matter, I think. Maybe give it some five or some value. And now if I go edit definition or on this guy here and say, yeah, delete it. And if I go do some other shape, let's see if that picks it up. It is an external sketch. I think I unlinked it. My bad there. Yeah, let me delete that altogether. It was an internal one there. So this is what we wanted to delete. And there it goes. It still says that you're removing, which, and as soon as I remove or replace, I think it's the new intent chain might still fail. Yeah, I don't think that didn't work anyways, but it could be that other intent, if I go back to this, let me even delete this intent. Right in here. Let me delete both of these. That other thing should work. I think there's a part intent, and if I go, you delete the manually done intent, and I do my new feature, and when I do that offset, and when I go pick from list, this guy, you know, it's to the part. And I'm gonna go select that intent and say 10. Because the manual intent didn't work, so at least the PTC's default intent hopefully can have a good fix for that. And just go remove material, that's working. Now I go to my edit this and go to the internal sketch of that guy and say, maybe we'll as soon as I remove everything, I think it probably removes the every single ID I'm thinking. We'll see if it can. No, that's the one that, so Dan, I think the solution here is to make sure when you do this kind of an offset chain, instead of using that sketch and going to, what is it?
Offset.
And then, offset and then using the chain,
mm-hmm.
single, but go with, it's like if you right click on it, pick from list, there should be an intent. I know it depends on, it so happened in this case, the intent is only on this because this is what is sketched. In this case, we had sketched it here, right? So we were mm-hmm. able to use it. So that, but then again, we shouldn't use a second offset, right? That's what, going back to the way that I did the offset, there was like, that's when that provide one helps a lot. If I go redefine it and edit that sketch in there, the way, even if I were to delete and redo, when I do that to offset and go pick from list, this first one is the most stable one. See, it shows the intent is to the part.
Okay.
And not the intent to the side surfaces, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's a little bit unstable. I mean, mainly they're more like, if you were to drag this over down here, right? How is that gonna behave? Is it gonna trickle down? Is it gonna take that or not? Part would be the most robust in there, but I don't know if you have that config setup, that should also help. I mean, you have to go to that, this would be a nice little provide fake message always. Yes, yeah, that seems to be the fix in there. So for it to work. Okay, any other questions? Let's see.
We probably should stop, okay. And then this will get recorded. It takes a little while to process it. Thank you so much. I like that intent stuff. I haven't really used that, and that seems really powerful.
Yeah.
And yeah, we'd like to have you again to finish up some of those tips and techniques that are still left there. So that would be great. Thank you so much.
Sure. We'll continue with, you know, we got a lot more on that, like general things and assembly. And yeah, we can do it as a second next session, Deb, I'm thinking. But yeah, thank you. Thanks.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you all. Yeah.
Bye, everybody.
Bye. Have a nice
Thank you.
Bye.